I'd like to welcome everyone to the July 17th, 2017 City of Portsmouth Planning Board. First order of business is approval of minutes from June 15th, June 22nd meetings, if I could have a motion.
So moved.
Any discussion on either one or any changes? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. Second order of business is determinations of completeness. There's three on our agenda. Item 3, 30 Cat Street is going to be postponed. We'll get to that in the detail, but I won't read that into the record for site review. So the first determination completeness is the application of Pease Development Authority owner and Summit Land Development LLC applicant for property located at 160 Corporate Drive. If I could have a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Not all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? The chair votes aye. Second item is the application of Pease Development Authority owner and 19 Rye Street LLC, care of 2 International Group applicant for property located at 19 Rye Street. If I could have a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The chair votes aye. Item B, determination of completeness for subdivision. The application of Alexander C. Garside and Nicole Outson, owners, for property located at 212 Park Street, and the Trudy Gould Irrevocable Living Trust owner, William A. Gould, trustee, for property located at 226 Park Street. Can I give a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? The chair votes aye. Item 3, public hearings, old business. The application of Ryan A. and Andrea A. Kress, owners, for property located at 185 Edmund Ave, and the City of Portsmouth owner for property located off Edmund Ave, requesting conditional use permit approval under section 10.1017 of the zoning ordinance for work within the inland wetland buffer to excavate an 8-foot by 55-foot area along the south and west side of the house, remove and replace the existing head wall and failing CMP culvert, and install new RCP culvert with a 750 square foot of temporary impact to the wetland buffer. Said properties are shown on the assessor's map 220 as lots 56 and 79 and lie within the single residence B in municipal districts. Who's here to speak for the applicant?
I am. Good evening, Mr. Chairman. I am David DeFosis from the City of Portsmouth Public Works Department. Here tonight, the City of Portsmouth is here working with the Cresses on their property. We're trying to acquire an easement to repair the culvert here that I'm circling on the overhead. You notice that that culvert has a dog leg to the left in it. Little background, the state of New Hampshire actually built that section of Edmund Ave as a replacement for Myrtle when Myrtle got buried by I-95. So as part of that, DOT put in proper reinforced concrete culverts across Myrtle, built the road for the City of Portsmouth. Subsequent to that, there was some subdivisions that went on. Mr. Kress's house by a former owner was constructed. As part of that effort, they actually did some filling in that yard to make the yard big enough and constructed that dog leg to the left improperly. For all intents and purposes, they used a different material type that we probably wouldn't use today. It's corrugated metal that has rusted. And they didn't put any sort of structure in at the angle. So wood, debris, animals get in there, cause all kinds of havoc, flooding time to time. So the city is doing a project to reconstruct Edmund Ave. As part of that effort, the city would get an easement to put in a drain manhole at the dog leg and then reconstruct the dog leg with proper reinforced concrete pipe. I'm here tonight with Mark Bouchelder from Seaport Engineering. He'll describe the nuances of the project, but basically that's a kind of overview of what's going on with the project and why we're here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Mark Bouchelder, Seaport Engineering. I was asked by the City of Portsmouth to help design or reconstruct this culvert So pretty much what we're proposing to do is at the location where this culvert dog legs, we'd like to put in a drain manhole and maintain the dog leg, but with having the drain manhole at that location where it changes directions, it would make it possible so that if any other debris or animals or the things that are causing problems now continue to happen, that there would be an access point instead of going up one end or the other of the culvert. And as Dave had said, the section that we would be replacing of the culvert is approximately 25 feet of 36-inch drain line, and we'd be replacing that with RCP instead of the existing corrugated metal. And at the inlet of the wetlands, which this section here is the inlet, and that's the outlet. The inlet, we would be proposing a new head wall, concrete cast in place head wall at that location. The existing conditions has a rough, I mean, it's pretty much just a bunch of rocks holding up the corrugated metal pipe, and there's a couple of pieces of wire mesh or something like that to try to keep out debris. But so we would like to clean that up with a proper head wall and the proper piping.
Any questions of the applicant? Mr. Clark.
Have you guys done any sort of analysis to make sure that the new culvert's of the proper size? I know you're just replacing a portion of it, but what if, you know, the other portion gets changed out in the future?
Well, what we essentially decided to do was just to this section in particular was just to replace it in kind with the same size. A full analysis of whether or not this line, including the line that crosses, we did not do an analysis to determine whether or not all of that would need to be replaced.
I mean, just my thought being, you know, just since everything's getting torn up, it'd probably be a good time to double check to make sure that 36 inch can handle all the new development that's taking place there, the change in land use, and then also, you know, just that way in the future, it doesn't have to get torn up again if it's...
I think we'd be happy to run that analysis just to make sure. There's been no history of flooding in that culvert area that has not had something to do with debris. So the culvert's, for all intents and purposes, we think, oversized as it is. So it free flows right now. But we'll be happy to run that analysis and just make sure it's a good plan. Thank you.
Okay.
Other questions of the applicant? Thanks, Mark. If not, we'll open it up to public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers. Third time speakers. See no one rise, we close the public hearing. What's the wish of the board?
Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion that we vote to grant the conditional use permit with the following stipulations, 1 and 2 in the planning department memo.
Second.
Could I also suggest that we add a third stipulation that we analyze the capacity, that the city of Portsmouth analyzes the capacity of that culvert?
I'll include that in the motion.
I'll second.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Chair votes aye.
Thank you. Have a good evening.
Thank you. Suggested that items B and C be discussed together and voted separately. I'll read them in and then I'll ask for a motion to consider these two items together. Item B, the application of Pease Development Authority owner and City of Portsmouth applicant for property located at 135 Corporate Drive, requesting conditional use permit approval under section 304.A.08 of the Pease land use controls for work within the inland wetland buffer to construct a 74-foot, 8-inch by 30-foot, 8-inch headworks building at the wastewater treatment facility consisting of three levels, one above ground and two below grade levels, with 23,790 square feet of impact to the wetland buffer. Said property is shown in assessor maps 303 as lot 6 and lies within the Pease Airport Business Commercial District. And item C, The application of Pease Development Authority owner and the City of Portsmouth applicant for property located at 135 Corporate Drive, requesting site plan approval under Chapter 400 of the Pease Land Use Controls. Site review regulations construct the 74-foot 8-inch by 30-foot 8-inch headworks building consisting of three levels, one above grade level and two below grade levels, totaling 2,290 square feet, with related paving, lighting, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said property is shown on Assessor's Map 303 as Lot 6 and lies within the Pease Airport Business Commercial District. If I could have a motion to consider these two items together.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The chair votes aye. Who's here to speak for the applicant?
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. My name is Don Song. I'm a wastewater project manager with the Department of Public Works, City of Portsmouth. We're here tonight to talk about a project that consists of a building that houses process equipment that will support the function of the wastewater treatment facility at Pease. We have here tonight a consultant that we're working with, Brian Roth from Stantec, and we've prepared a short presentation for you, if that's okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. So the project team for this, Terry Damaris with the city, Don Sung, Steve Calabro, the project manager, is running late, and myself, the design project engineer, and I'll be the construction manager for the project. Pease Wastewater Treatment Plant is zoned airport business commercial. It's part of the Pease Development Authority. It was originally installed in the 1950s, serves Pease, Portsmouth, Newington, Greenland, has current daily flows of roughly 500,000 gallons per day with projected with peak current flows of 1.3 million gallons per day and future development expected to be close to 5 million gallons per day, which is the reason why we're here, the upgrade of the existing wastewater treatment facility. This is the entire wastewater treatment facility site. We will be working specifically within this boxed area. Specific to that, this is the location of the existing headworks building. This is the proposed headworks building, and this is the septage receiving building, which is the other part of the other part of this project, performing upgrades to that facility that will better suit the treatment facility. So a quick overview of what's happening as part of this project. We'll be replacing the outdated headworks building. The headworks building is basically the first line of defense for wastewater treatment. If that's not functioning as it should be, basically all the treatment down the line for the treatment plant suffers and needs quicker replacement than what is normally necessary. We'll be adding carbon filter systems. Currently, all of the Pease wastewater treatment facilities odor control systems have fiberglass reinforced pipes, which are below the groundwater level, so all of those are not functioning. So what we will be doing as part of this project is replacing all of those. With this project, as part of the headworks building, we'll be replacing the screening system, the grit removal system, the influent pumping. We'll be providing improvements to the septage receiving building, as I said, and drainage improvements on the site. Currently, there's a lot of ponding areas on site where the grades don't work, and regrade and repave portions of the site to accommodate these two improvements to the buildings. So this is a rendering of the site from across the street before, as it exists now, and this is a view after with the building in place. This is an elevation view of the proposed headworks building. One level will be above grade, as the chairman indicated. Two will be below grade. This is ground level of the headworks facility. This is a mid-level section of the headworks facility. And this is the floor level of the groundworks facility. This is a 3D view of the building. This is from the driveway side or corporate drive, actually. So essentially we would have in this location for garbage refuse pickup and three doors, and basically a building consistent with the current construction of buildings on site. These are basically what each elevation would look like on the building as we're proposing. And these are more recent, recently constructed buildings within the Pease Wastewater Treatment Plant. We're proposing a brick face and roof system that is consistent with all these to be consistent on site. This is the existing outdated Headworks building. As you can see, it doesn't really fit in with the other three here. This is the existing septage receiving building, also newly installed, 1999, I believe. And we'll be working primarily so that septage receiving can occur on this side of the building in lieu of this side. Currently, the way the grades are configured, septage receiving trucks need to be discharged into this building. We're raising the grades on this side of the building to allow for a better gravity system for septage receiving at the site. So this is the site plan specific to the site. What this red line here is the 100-foot wetland setback or buffer. This is the delineated wetlands here. We are in the wetlands buffer for a good portion of the site. This darker shaded area is proposed impervious paved surface for the use of the new Headworks building and the new location of the septage receiving building. This lighter gray is where we're removing and replacing existing pavement to make the grades work on site, essentially. As part of the proposed improvements, we are proposing a 3-foot by 3-foot infiltration trench on the downhill side of all proposed impervious pavement to catch all runoff from site and treat it prior to discharging to the wetlands. This is a summary of basically the utilities required for the site. Currently, the storm drainage from the highway goes through where we're proposing the existing building. So the first step will be to reroute that drain system with 3-foot diameter HDPE pipes back to where it discharges on this side, where we would connect into the existing drain system. There's also a city water supply that goes through the building as well that we will be rerouting. Additionally, as part of the proposed building, we have a force main that discharges to the existing force main and some additional catch basins that will tie into this drainage system to eliminate ponding areas that I discussed before. That does it for my presentation. At this point, I'll open up for any questions or comments.
Questions for the applicant? Mr. Clark.
So you have the trench that's on the outside of the entrance road.
Yes.
So that's just catching the runoff from the road, correct? It doesn't treat other catch basins, CB1, CB2, that all tie in the manhole.
That's correct. It wouldn't treat those, but those are deep sump catch basins with oil grease eliminators, oil grease hood eliminators that are the city standards. And part of our discussion with the CONSCOM is that a schedule would be developed to routinely clean out those catch basins. I believe it was times a year. So that was as part of the approval. That was a condition.
All right. And then my other question was, did you guys look into basically treating anything coming from that 30-inch that you guys are basically rerouting around the site?
No, there really isn't a way to, quite honestly. All that we're doing is it currently runs like this through where the building's going, and now we're rerouting it like that.
Right.
Essentially.
Yeah, so I was just, I guess my thought being, it'd be probably a good time to try to do some treatment of that before it gets discharged right into the brook right there. So I didn't know if you guys had looked into subsurface infiltration gallery or something, you know, basically to the left of that proposed headworks building. There's not many utilities over in that area.
Right.
It's kind of, you know, it just hasn't been touched as far as, you know, with utilities. And then also I noticed we have another applicant in front of us tonight that's basically across the street that's doing a subsurface infiltration gallery to try to treat some of that stormwater prior to having it discharged into the wetlands, so.
We hadn't considered it for a couple of reasons. One, the proximity to the building. Another, because there's a lot of-
Can you just talk into the microphone? It's just so it picks up our audio.
I'm sorry. We hadn't considered it for a couple of reasons. One, the proximity of the building. Two, we didn't want to extend too far this way to have additional setback impacts for the installation of the drain. Three, it's a clay, like a marine clay soil in this area, so I don't even know that we would get the infiltration for that. So that is basically the reasons we didn't look into that.
Okay.
Other questions of the applicant? Ms. Begala.
Yes, I just wanted a clarification. You said, sure, that the gray area there is pervious or impervious?
Impervious.
Impervious.
It's a pavement. Yeah.
So,
yep.
Because the write-up says that you reduced the pavement, which I understand, but I'm still trying to understand how 24,000 square feet of, you know, wetland buffer impact is actually minimizing the impact.
So not all that is the impervious, that buffer impacts. A majority of that is this area here, which will need to basically slope away from the building and then restore as it is existing. Originally, what we had for a design was this access way came through here. We had a hammerhead to the odor control unit, which got moved to this side over here, and then it got extended to this far. So we eliminated the part where we eliminated the impervious was that previous design of the hammerhead extending into the buffer here and put the odor control unit on this side. So this design is a reduction from that original design, essentially.
I'm sure you considered locating that new driveway, which is to the south of the existing receiving building, to the north, that would run somewhat outside of the 100-foot buffer, and you chose not to. So could you explain why you came up with this design?
The issue is essentially this location here where we're relocating the septage receiving. This is really the only place we can relocate that and make the grades work. So instead of just having that specifically for this building, it's a dual use for this building and that building, and to run the turning movements, basically to have the type of vehicles that will be operating through this site, we need a through movement of that area by both buildings, essentially.
Other questions of the applicant? Ms. Begala.
I just wanted to make sure then the 24,000 square feet is a permanent impact.
No, no.
It's only an impact while you're working on the site?
Yes.
So of the 24,000, roughly 10,000 is a permanent impact. That's this impervious area here. The remaining is this infiltration trench and the existing grass, which will be returned to grass. This is sheet 0 of 95 in the package. So it's the...
Could you take a minute just to explain it? Because my interpretation of the staff memo was that the 23,790 square feet would be permanent impact. And if that's not the case, I mean, it may be worthwhile if you guys could just,
sure,
take us through,
sure,
exactly
so
where this is, the impact is.
This is specifically what we're talking about right here, the impact. So it's broken out by the type of impact and the square footage impact.
Got it.
So on the left are permanent impacts, and on the right are temporary impacts. Permanent impacts basically would be the building and would be the paved impervious area. Temporary impacts would basically be the area which is grass, which we're going to return to grass, or within 25 feet of the wetland, turn into a natural vegetative material.
So to be clear, for the rest of the board, the permanent impact on this sheet is 10,152 square feet, and the temporary impact is 13,638 square feet.
It is shown on the plan.
Yeah, it is shown on the plan. I misinterpreted the staff memo. All right, thank you for that explanation.
Yep. Yep.
Other questions? If not, we'll open up. Thank you. If not, we'll open up the public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Any second-time speakers? Third-time speakers? Close the public hearing. What's the wish of the board?
Mr. Chair, on the wetland conditional use permit, I vote that we recommend that the CUP be approved with the stipulations 1 through 4 in the planning board memo.
Second.
Any discussion? Not all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The chair votes aye. We also need a motion on the site plan review.
Mr. Chair, I'll vote that we recommend site plan approval.
Second.
Any discussion? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
The chair votes aye. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Gamester.
You're welcome, Mr. Chair.
Item D, the application of Society for the Preservation of New England Antiquities of Mass owner for property located at 62 and 76 Northwest Street, requesting conditional use permit approval under section 10.1017 of the zoning ordinance for work within the tidal wetland buffer consisting of minor grading around the house, a new yard drain system, two new grass swales, and a level spreader with 3,400 square feet of impact on the wetland buffer. Said properties are shown in Assessor's Map 141 as Lot 29 and Assessor's Map 122 as Lot 9 and lie within the General Residence A District and the Historic District. Who's here to speak for the applicant?
Good evening. Good evening, Mr. Chairman and board members. My name is Sean Beckwith, and I'm the preservation manager for the North Region for Historic New England. The Jackson House is one of the properties that I maintain out of the 12 in the area that I take care of. What would you like? Would you like me to give you a full explanation of the project? What I'd like to do is I'd like to introduce my engineer, Mr. Don Woods, who will be able to speak more clearly about site drainage than I can.
Great, thank you.
Hi, I'm Don Woods, professional engineer, working with Historic New England on this project. Jackson House is actually the oldest, I guess, wood frame house in the state of New Hampshire. Over the years, the grade has built up around the building and especially Northwest Street, which has been built up. Northwest Street here. Here's the Jackson House right there. Historic New England owns all of this. There's actually two parcels. This is the Jackson House Museum. This is actually a house that they rent out to tenants. Northwest Street and Jackson Hill Street over the years has built up the grade around the Jackson House is built up also to the point where there's adverse grades coming into the building. So here's the Jackson House here. This was actually the original house. Then there were three additions put on at various times in the history of the house itself. This is the lean-to portion that actually backs right up to Northwest Street, excuse me, where the eave is almost right on the, just above the ground level there. And what happens is there's two small little areas right there because the lean-to addition doesn't go all the way across the whole building. But these are the areas, especially where the drainage is actually getting caught in there and going underneath the building, and there's no basement under that portion. And here, what's happening is the drainage is actually going into the basement. And across this side of the house and this side of the house, the grades are such that the water comes off the roof and a good portion of it actually drains back into the foundation, which is just dry laid stone. So that's sort of the path of least resistance for it. So they've had problems with the foundation there over the years, and moisture in the house itself mainly due to all that water that's ending up in the basement. So what the proposal is to, on this side here, to actually just do some grading to create a shallow grass swale to be able to drain this area out and down the slope. And in here, this one, the grading is such that we weren't able to do it with a grass swale because it would have had to have been so deep there. And this is actually the access into the property and into the building, so we couldn't sort of excavate too deeply there. So what's happening here is we've got four yard drains, just small plastic pipe, vertical pipe to I think it's a 6-inch storm drain that runs down here. And then down here we have another swale just to pick up the water that's coming down the hill and eventually ends up into what's called a level spreader. So when we've got all, and actually this swale up here also ends up going into the level spreader. And what the level spreader does is takes all that concentrated runoff and then actually spreads it back out again to sheet flow before it's discharged over existing grass surface again, undisturbed grass surface. This is all lawn and orchard in here. Before it gets to the bank and then the wetland below, which is the tidal marsh along North Mill Pond. One of the issues that there are too is the fact that this being such an old house, and also they're getting some grant monies from the state of New Hampshire, LCHIP, so they've done extensive archaeology work. And Sean can probably tell you a little bit more about it, but they've come up with a massive amount of archaeology, some of it not very far below ground, and some of it obviously going back to the 1600s. So we had to work around all of that, which is how we ended up with this. So all of the areas that we're proposing to work around the building, and actually this area here too, and this swale down here have been tested archaeologically. So those have, you know, we're working within the results of the archaeology there. And we've also received our state shoreland permit and our state wetlands permits.
Questions of the applicant? Ms. Pagala?
Yeah, I'm just interested, are you the same engineer who put in the 4-inch deep drainage pipe in 2005?
No.
So that drainage pipe is failing somehow, is that correct?
Well, I took a look at that, and that pipe runs right along the eave of that lean-to roof that comes right down along parallel to Northwest Street. And then there's, the pipe runs there, comes down here, and they installed a dry well, a small dry well there, and there's no outlet to that. They didn't put in any cleanouts or anything, so we really don't know what the condition of that is at this point in time. But that was put in to try and alleviate any groundwater potential, not so much the surface water. All that's being done with this proposal is to deal with the surface runoff.
Other questions?
I noticed that the plans, the full-scale plans that the planning board has in its possession are actually stamped versus these, which are marked review and comment only. I assume that's because they're of different scale and they're not actually different plans?
We must have gotten the wrong CV to the wrong person. Okay.
So, but we are reviewing the plans that the board has in hand, yeah.
Yeah, they haven't.
Nothing has been altered from the previous submissions. So I'm very sorry for our administrative error.
Good question. Any other questions?
If I may add just real quick, like,
can you hear me okay? The reason also for some of the drainage work that we're having around the building is that we are collecting a lot of moisture, and basically there's not a whole bunch above, but yes, the roadway is up. We do get a fair amount of snow and it does build, and it captures around both sides of the house. Oops, which one? Oh, there it is. In here where the tree was before and the tree failed, that actually moved part of the earlier drainage from the 1950s and also the recent drainage. And so that made that defunct. But over here on the other side of the building where it's a low area, it collects also there. What we're having a problem right now is that moisture is getting in, the insects are getting in, and we're having sill problems. So we need to get the grade down to get it dried out, and then this will also divert the water around the building. We're not adding any surface volume, we're not adding anything. And it's sort of, it's almost like who came first, the chicken or the egg? The building came first, and then over time the road has built up. So we're just trying our basic low impact just to be able to save the structure. Regarding the archaeology, which is really intense, Kathleen Wheeler with Independent Archaeology Associates, I imagine you've worked with her an awful lot. She had already done earlier work on the building, actually in the lean-to area. She got a few things, not too much. She started going outside. She did. She hit the mother lode. Unfortunately, that's sort of good and bad. She found 19,000 artifacts all over the site in the selective areas that she dug. Some of it goes back to the early 1600s and it rivals what was found at Strawberry Bank. We found this really cool, there's this plate that was found in Virginia, I'll hurry this along, in Jamestown, Virginia, with a blue bunny plate on it. It goes back to the 1640s. It's actually a Portuguese tinware. We have the same thing. So it actually is really, really cool. She found an enormous amount of bones, so she said somebody could do a master's or a PhD study on the foodways of Portsmouth in the area. So hopefully we'll be able to develop a little bit more on that to help and enrich the community and the understanding of the cultural history in Portsmouth area, and we'll take from there. She really did some really good work, but yes, unfortunately we do have evidence in the south side of the building that is very close to the surface, so now we have to work a little bit differently with the different problems. But it's we were doing our due diligence. LCHIP is reviewing it right now. It is part of an LCHIP grant. The Jackson family is actually part of the first families in New Hampshire. So it is a very important building, and it is a study house for us, and we're very happy and eager to save it as best we can.
Thanks for the detail on a challenging site. Any other questions, the applicant, Ms. Begala?
This is just a question for edification. So I'm sure there's a very long answer to this, but could you briefly just explain why this is not part of Strawberry Bank? I'm just curious, is it because of the archaeological site?
No, you have to forgive me. I'm new to the area, and I've only been with the organization for 2 years. Historic New England is the largest and oldest historic preservation organization in the nation. They purchased this building in 1924, and I think Strawberry Bank started a little bit after that, and this is actually on the other side of town from Strawberry Bank.
Okay, thank you. I thought it just was related. Thank you so much.
Other questions, the applicant? Thank you both. We'll open it now to a public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Any second-time speakers? Third-time speakers? We'll close the public hearing. What's the wish of the board?
Mr. Chair, I'd make a motion that we vote to recommend approval of the conditional use permit with the included stipulation.
Seconded. Any discussion? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. Thank you. Item E.
Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening. The application of Gary and Ariel Celanta, owners, for property located at 4 Sylvester Street, requesting conditional use permit approval to create a two-bedroom, 676-square-foot detached accessory dwelling unit on the second story of a garage to be constructed with associated paving, lighting, and utilities. Said property is shown on the assessor's map 232 as lot 36 and lies within the single residence B district. Who's here to speak for the applicant?
So I'm Ariel Silimpa. I'm speaking because I lost the rock, paper, scissors duel.
My condolences.
So our project is pretty cut and dry. We have a single family home that was built around 1900 that just severely lacks storage. I have five children in the house right now. We foster parent, and we'd really like to build a garage. And thinking ahead to the fact that we have aging parents, we wanted to put some living area above the garage. We're also thinking in the teen years that my husband and I could go and hide in that area of the garage. Essentially, the garage will be a detached unit, 676 square feet. Initially, we had postponed from the last meeting because we wanted to build the garage on the right-hand side of our house. After a meeting with Dave DeFossis from the Department of Public Works and Vincent from the Planning Department, it was deemed that because of the way our road is and snow removal, that it made a lot better sense to move it to the left side of the house. It also makes better sense because Sylvester Street is a dead-end street, and we're the last house on the street economically for us to put the garage on that side of the home. As you can see, there's just a very basic site plan that we've laid out for you. Sylvester Street there on the left. Here, let's see if I can get this to go.
This is actually the old plan.
Oh.
So we didn't update it.
Oh,
okay. Sorry about that. So for the planning board's reference, this is the one, if you flip it, that's what they're proposing.
Yes, if you move the garage essentially just to the opposite side of the house. And the only other thing that's pertinent is we're going to have to move the driveway as well, since we can only have one driveway permit in Portsmouth. There's also an easement. So Dave was really kind, and there's currently an easement situation going on where he suggested that we could just move the easement over slightly to be able to build the garage on that side of the house. I've spoken with Suzanne in the legal department, and she was putting that in the works. But for all intents and purposes, we meet all of the setback requirements, and it's going to be a pretty cut and dry project for us.
Questions for the applicant? Mr. Clark.
So I see, is that an existing garage that you guys have behind where you proposed the new one, or a shed?
No, it's interesting. Someone asked, I was here for something else a while back. So that is a structure that was on the property when we bought it, that not last winter, the winter before, because of the snow load, just collapsed. And that structure is no longer there. We've completely removed it. It was a structure we never used. It actually wasn't even a safe structure when we bought our home. Because we had bigger fish to fry, we just kind of fenced it off and pretended it wasn't there. And then after all the snow we had the winter before last, we could just no longer pretend that it wasn't there. We had to get rid of it.
All right.
Are there questions for the applicant? Thank you. We'll open it up to public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers. Third time speakers. Close the public hearing. What's the wish of the board?
Mr. Chair, I'd make a motion that we vote to grant the conditional use permit as presented, but with the four stipulations that are listed in the planning board memo.
Seconded.
Discussion? So the only thing I would point out is the planning department's analysis for traffic and parking suggests that while technically the off-street requirement is delivered, the way the parking is structured would require cars to go over existing spaces, which suggests that oftentimes two cars would be parked on the on the street, although technically you can get four cars. I'd be very concerned if this was a through street, but since it's not, and having said that, it does limit the parking driveway. So you could argue that requiring something different would actually increase the impervious. Mm-hmm. So it's a bit of a balance, right? Mm-hmm. But I'm going to vote for this, but I do worry that we need to be thoughtful, particularly as we approach what is relatively new for the city, the ADUs, that we think carefully when we look at our existing ordinance and receive applications. Any other comments? If not,
I think the only reason why I am comfortable with it is because it is an end. Yes. It's a dead end street, and therefore it can't really create a whole lot of traffic.
Yeah, and that's where I ended up too. But I think I'd feel different if it were a through street.
I agree.
Okay. So we have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, I'll call the motion. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? The chair votes aye. Thank you. So where are we here?
All right.
Item F?
Yes, there's an
item F.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, are we?
Oak Street. No, we're on Oak Street.
Right. Where are we?
We're on Oak Street.
Okay. Item F, request of Deborah Reagan to transfer title to half of the paper street known as Oak Street that abuts 43 Mangrove Street. This is a city council referral. Who's here to speak for this applicant?
Thank you. So we opened the public hearing last time, and did we open the public hearing last time? I don't remember. But you're welcome to come up and talk. She was concerned. She didn't know what to say. That's fine.
I think I don't recall. Did we open the public hearing? I don't think we did. We didn't.
I'm sorry I don't have some nice pictures. Okay. My name is Jen Armstrong. I'm the current owner of the property, and I bought it from Deborah Reagan in March. Kathy McCauley, who was here to speak for this request last time, is not here this evening. But I just thought I would describe what the situation is because it's a little unusual. I live on the corner of what would be Oak Street and Mangrove if the paper street had been created. And so it was, you know, set off. It doesn't belong to either my neighbor or myself. In the front, where our two front yards abut what would have been Oak Street, we're both sort of splitting the care for it at this point. At the back, where our backyards don't would abut the street, nobody's taking care of it. They have a fence in their backyard, so it's on their property line. But it's gotten really overgrown, and it's my interest in it is not just to basically be caring for the thing that I own, but also my property line when I bought the house that was directly under. It's a 1950s house built at that time, but the property line is directly where my deck at the time stopped and where the septic system is. So I'd like to have that couple of feet so that those things aren't directly on the property line. I've since got a permit and taken that deck off and made a stairway that's not right on the property line, but the septic system is still there. So that's my primary interest in this.
Questions for the applicant? I think you did a nice job.
Thank you.
So I'll now open up to public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers? Third time speakers? I'll close the public hearing. Thank you. What's the wish of the board?
Mr. Chair, I'd make a motion we vote to recommend the city release any interest it may have in the paper street known as Oak Street.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Moreau. We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Yes.
Chair, I have, I just want to kind of reiterate some of the verbiage in the planning director's report, which suggests that the city actually doesn't know that it has an interest to be releasing in this street. We've seen this before, and we would request actually that, you know, if there comes a time when you do the research to actually prove that you have ownership to that street, that you would come to the assessing department with that information, and then the lot line could actually be officially recorded and become part of your lot. I know it's a strange situation,
yeah,
but, you know, it really is, the onus is on the applicant to prove that they own it. We don't know that we do.
Yeah, so. I mean, based on what the legal department has done to date and a previous exploration we did for the location of a potential senior center here, the title search indicated we don't actually have any ownership here. Hmm. But to verify that finally would require a little bit more research, and what I've already advised is that they really need to do the title research on their own to determine who is the actual interest in this property, because if it's not the city, they need to know who else it is.
Good. Any other comments or discussion? Not all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. Thank you. So moving on to public hearings, new business. Item A, the application of 30 Maplewood LLC owner for property located at 30 Maplewood Ave for a conditional use permit under section 10.535.12 of the zoning ordinance as adopted when the project was vested through design review approval in December 2013. To allow an increase in building height above the maximum height specified in section 10.531. Said property is shown in assessor's plan 125 as lot 2 and lies within character district 4, downtown overlay district and historic district. Who's here to speak for the applicant?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. John Shagnon from Ambit Engineering, here to speak on behalf of the applicant. I don't know how many of you were on the planning board in 2013 when the design review was accomplished, but I suspect not many of you, but the project.
I was here.
The only one.
This one. So.
Enough of us.
It's been a while. And the project has been in design.
So be consistent.
Yes.
She'll remember.
She'll remember.
The project has been in design at the HDC for some time. It's been refined, and we came in and got that design review approval to vest the project back at that time. There were a lot of zoning changes that were circling around. So what the process involves now is the Historic District Commission can grant the conditional use permit for a certain number of items which are listed. And what they have to do, though, is that proposal shall be reviewed by the planning board prior to that final consideration by the HDC. So we're here to get your feedback, I believe, and that feedback gets transmitted to the HDC, and then that process is completed. And we'll be back soon, I hope, with site plan review plans for you to complete the process, and then this corner can be developed as shown on these plans. So one of the things that HDC or the ordinance requires for a conditional use permit is that we satisfy criteria, and there are a number of possible ways to get the additional relief or allow for additional building in this case. And in this particular instance, there are four that are highlighted. And the first is civic space. And I don't know what we have in the way of site plans. I think we thought we had the, there it is. So, the project is at the corner of Maplewood Avenue and Deer Street. This is 30 Maplewood Avenue. It was the Health and Human Services building, was redeveloped into a second story was added. It's commercial first floor, residential second, and penthouse or upper floor. The lot that 4664 Maplewood is going to sit on was created, it was cut off of the piece. We came through a subdivision process about 6 months ago, and some of the board members might recall that. The VFW building is kind of a separate parcel that is surrounded or was surrounded by the 30 Maplewood site, which went block to block all the way up to Hanover Street. So the 46 building will be on its own lot, and that lot will be covered by the building, but there is some civic space, widened sidewalks along Maplewood and Deer Street. There was a passageway here that will connect the 30 Maplewood building across the 46 lot to Deer Street, providing some public access. And there's also another directional access. Oops.
It's just sideways.
By the way.
Some technological issues, I think.
There's east-west access from Maplewood to Bridge Street. So the civic space is the public open space, the widened sidewalks, the plaza area here at the Maplewood end, which will have some benches and hopefully potentially some commercial uses that spill out onto the sidewalk and make the space lively. The building first floor is recessed, so the public space is further extended to the face of the building. It has other floors above. Second way that the building is striving to get the additional allowances through the conditional use permit is the parking. So the building has an entrance on Deer Street, which ramps down to an underground parking level. And so all the parking is concealed. There's a, I believe there are the renderings here. And if you look at the Deer Street side, you see that garage door entrance. So that will serve to hide all the parking in a below grade parking area. So the parking needs will be provided in a concealed parking area. The third criteria is the use of building materials. High quality materials, masonry, composites, glass, metal. I think the applicants have worked long and hard with the HCC to provide the look of the building, which has a lot of articulation, different elements of building material that provide for interest but go together. This is the view from across the corner, Maplewood on the left, Deer on the right. This is the view from across Maplewood with the plaza area. And you can see the widened sidewalk, the area underneath the upper floors that is open to pedestrian traffic. The fourth item of the building scale elements, scale and massing techniques. I think the one of the requests is to have the penthouse level not be stepped back as far in this particular instance, and I think that the Historic District Commission and the applicant worked closely on that. The District Commission wanted the building to be more prominent, to sort of sit taller to the street, and that's led to the need for this additional variance from the development criteria. Hopefully I've expressed what needs to be expressed, and we appreciate your time and look forward to your comments.
Before we take questions, I do want to point out one inconsistency, and Juliet, correct me if I'm wrong, but the applicant's information that was submitted to the board says they're asking for CPU for both the penthouse setback and the height.
Right.
And that second item, in fact, is my understanding, is in fact inaccurate. They already have the height approved at 45 feet. So the only thing that we're considering is the penthouse setback.
Correct. So when the zoning that was in place at the time had it, you could be 3.5 stories or 45 feet maximum, and both of those conditions had to be met. In this case, the applicant is 45 feet, which is okay, but the penthouse doesn't meet our definition, so therefore it actually qualifies as a fourth story, even though it, you know, is scaled back somewhat from the, you know, technically is a penthouse in all, in the way it's represented, but it doesn't meet the definition of penthouse in our ordinance. And I think my follow-up memo just also alluded to the fact that this has gone through substantial review with the Historic District Commission, and based on what I have learned from Nick Cracknell and my discussions with him, is that this is actually a design that's sort of come to collaboratively with the HDC, so that including the design of the penthouse. And I would also mention, because Ms. Moreau pointed this out earlier, that even though technically this got approval for design review in 2013, subsequent to that, they did apply for site plan review approval. It has just been a long time in front of land use boards, both HDC and some preliminary meetings with the TAC. So there were some periods of inactivity, but overall it's been an active application since December of 2013.
Thank you. Any questions of the applicant? Ms. Moreau.
So I get the garage entrance that's on Deer Street, but there also behind the VFW looks like there's an entrance that comes off of Bridge Street. Is that to the same parking structure, or is that, because I know originally in the plan you were only doing ground level parking, sort of covered underneath. You weren't doing below ground, so that's what I'm trying to figure out what the two entrances are.
Sure, good question. So the site has a grade change from the corner of Maplewood Deer to this side on Bridge Street, and it's actually going to be at a different level than the first floor at the corner of Maplewood Deer and just be at grade first level parking that is arrived at from Bridge Street. So it's not the same parking structure. In fact, the underground parking is stopped to the left of this area that is the at grade parking, because there would not be enough headroom below that parking for another parking level. So they're sort of two separate and distinct parking areas.
Right. So really the benefit, sorry, can I keep going?
I have some questions.
So I just want to make sure I'm summarizing and understanding. So the benefit we're getting for the extra penthouse, which by the way, the building is totally different from 2013, but it looks awesome, is the much wider sidewalks, the pathways through that are open to the public, right, on both off of Maplewood and off of Deer Street, and, you know, the wider sort of areas that are sort of at the corner of Maplewood and the one that's off in between the two buildings on Maplewood. I just want to make sure I'm summing this up right.
Correct.
That's it.
Thank you. Other questions, the applicant?
My question is about parking, too, but it's actually not about this building. It's about the 30 Maplewood building. This was a parking lot. Did it serve as the parking for the six or seven condos that are in the 30 Maplewood building? And where
no,
are those
the
spots
parking,
going?
I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, go ahead.
The parking, there's a parking field over here.
Oh, so that's not part of the VFW then?
Correct. That's
okay.
Not.
Okay.
It's part of the 30 Maplewood site. So
gotcha.
46 sort of has an easement to cross, and they have a couple of parking spaces beyond that garage door that we just looked at. But this parking here is all associated with 30.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks. Other questions, Ms. McCullough?
Yeah, I just wanted to ask you about the penthouse or the fourth floor. So is that actually a residence, or I don't know if I'm remembering that it was this property that was talked about previously that was gonna have a rooftop, you know, restaurant with a terrace and views of the river and all that kind of thing? No.
I believe it's all residential.
Okay.
Yes.
Is that,
yeah.
That's across the street on the new Foundry Street?
Yeah. It's probably Harbor Corp.
That's Harbor Corp.
Harbor Corp.
That's Harbor Corp.
Okay. And then, I'm sorry, I've read it about 15 times, but I don't really understand the zero setback. Are you talking about a zero setback of the roof line? The development has a zero setback in the Maplewood Deer Street intersection and 52% of the floor area below. I guess I just don't understand where the zero setback, 0 foot.
It's right at the corner.
It's right at the corner.
I guess that would be this section right here.
Right.
So the building is sort of vertical here, but it's stepped back as you go down Deer Street and as you go down Maplewood. So it's right at the corner, the curve of the corner.
Okay, so I just want to make sure you've considered like snow and ice removal from the roof to make sure that pedestrians aren't injured.
Yes, in the case of these types of flat-roofed buildings, they are drained internally and they're connected to the system. So there's really less chance of ice falling off the roof than with a sloped roof.
Other questions of the applicant? Thanks, John.
Okay.
We'll open it up to a public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers? Third time speakers? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. So, what the HDC is looking for are comments from this board that will be summarized and submitted to them for their review and consideration as they're looking at the CUP.
Mr. Chair, I make a motion that we vote to forward a summary of comments raised during our discussion to the Historic District Commission so that we can have our discussion.
Okay, I'm good with that.
Seconded.
So, all right, so we have a vote and a second. So now we can open up for discussion. Thank you.
I'll get started. Yeah. I'm excited the fact to see that they're actually doing the underground parking now, which was not part of the original design. And that does really alleviate a lot of parking issues, especially with the residences going in. So I see that as a total bonus. I'm excited about the public throughways through the property so that there are the alleyways so that you don't have to go around the entire block in order to get around these buildings. You can pass through, but the public is welcome to cut through the property. I see that as also a huge bonus to being able to have the penthouse. Yeah, I'll stop there. I'm sure other people have things to say.
Other comments? Councilor Perkins.
Sure. I second a lot of what Ms. Moreau said. I also appreciate that in these plans there's clearly a contemplation of all four sides of the building. It presents really well in context. I mean, I think it looks beautiful, and I think the HGC has done a great job. I appreciate that it brings some architectural variety to the area, which I also think is a real addition to the character of the area. And I agree that the pedestrian way is something we've definitely heard feedback on and is an important part of the design.
Other comments? Yeah, and I'd just like to echo it. I think more than anything, the process in this one worked. And I appreciate what the HDC has done, what the applicant has done to get to a much better outcome for everybody. And I'm certain that the HDC will make a wise decision when this is put in front of them. So I guess if there's no more comments, I guess we need a vote to send those along. So I have a vote for approval.
Aye.
Aye.
All in favor?
Aye.
Sorry about that, guys. Threw me a curveball. Any opposed? I'll vote aye. Thanks, John.
Thank you. We look forward to coming back soon.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Oh, yeah. Okay. So which ones do we have? So what page is that? Okay, 15. And then what's the other?
The final one is the last. It's all the way at the end. So.
There it is. So we have two items that are going to be postponed that are later on the agenda, and I thought that we would announce those now and vote on postponement in case anyone is here wishing to speak on those applicants. I don't want to waste your time. So it, the first one is item F, that's on page 15 of the staff memo. The application is Steve H. Lee, owner for property located at 174 Dodge Ave, requesting conditional use permit approval to create a two-story, 1,000-square-foot garden cottage in an existing building, associated paving, lighting, and utilities. Said property is shown on Assessor's Map 258 as Lot 43 and lies within the single residence B district. If I may have a motion to postpone.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Chair votes aye. And item K, page 22 of the staff memo. The application of Merton Allen Investments, LLC owner for property located at 30 Kate Street, requesting amended site approval to remove the 10-foot wide walkthroughs in the center of 2 8-unit buildings and move the units together to provide a 20-foot wide separation between the 6-unit building to create a 2 3-unit building, and the revision of grading utilities to accommodate the new building locations. Said property is shown on Assessor's Map 165 as Lot 1 and lie within the character district 4W. If I have, may have a motion to postpone.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The chair votes aye.
All right. Just thank for you. Clarification, that was David Moore first motion and Councillor Perkins seconding.
Wow, your ears are pretty good.
Our minute taker is in the back. I just want to make sure she gets
that. Tie goes to the runner.
Yeah, I know. I'm impressed. All right, so we're in item B. Think, right?
Yes.
Yes.
All right. Item B, page 11. The application of Eversource Energy, owner of right-of-way for property located off Ocean Road and Greenland Road, requesting conditional use permit approval under section 10.1017 of the zoning ordinance for work within the inland wetland and inland wetland buffer for the reconstruction of 26 existing utility poles with 222,120 square feet of impact to the inland wetland and 64,714 square feet of impact to the inland wetland buffer. Said properties are shown in Assessor's Map 281, 282, and 258 lie within the Municipal Natural Resource Protection, Rural, and Industrial Districts. Who's here to speak for the applicant?
Thanks so much for your time tonight. My name is Tracy Tarr. I'm a wetland scientist with GZA Geoenvironmental. We completed the wetland delineation in the right-of-way, as well as a wetland permitting. I'm here with Kurt Nelson, a permitting specialist with Eversource, and Kevin Clough, a construction representative of Eversource, in case you have more technical questions for us. Thanks so much for setting up those plans.
And excuse me, but I just want to ask the chairman, I'm going to recuse myself because okay. I received an abutters notice for this. But I would like to comment that on Next Door Neighbor, there's been extensive discussions about all the fox. There's, I don't know, it's fox season out there. So the Great Bog and areas that are, you know, going to be affected by this construction do have a lot of baby foxes.
Ms. Bedell, if you're recusing yourself, you really need to recuse yourself.
Okay, then I'm recusing myself. Sorry.
No, we do appreciate those comments. We do actually have extensive BMPs for wildlife, which I'll touch on. I think that'll be of interest. The project includes a replacement, you said it well, so I won't reiterate, the replacement of 26 existing transmission line poles in the E194 and U181 right away. Those are just ways to identify those transmission lines. The project is roughly overall 1.6 miles in length, extending from the nearby Ocean Road substation in Greenland to Greenland Road in Portsmouth. The line is actually nearly 67 years old, construction around 1950, and is showing serious signs of age. The 26 poles that need immediate replacement have horizontal splitting, rotting, and actually cavities from age, as well as woodpecker holes. And if those poles fail, the line could fail, so those must be replaced. The replacement poles will be direct embed steel poles in caissons instead of wood for obvious reasons. Eversource doesn't want to see additional rotting to protect the line. And then the access routes you see in front of you, the yellow boxes, if you will, and the yellow lines, those are proposed access routes through wetlands. And because those are wetlands, timber matting is put down to provide a safe, stable surface, as well as to protect wetlands and prevent rutting. And then from the matting, erosion controls are installed, including straw wattle and silt fence where necessary. Some of the other BMPs that will be used, we obviously met with the Conservation Commission. They requested that we remove invasive species from holes, from those drilling locations, and bag them appropriately and dispose off-site. We've added that BMP to our sheet. We've also done a few minor BMP edits that we sent to the Planning Department, and that's in your file. And the fund BMPs, to get at the initial question on wildlife, we did have a pre-application meeting with the DES Wetlands Bureau, Army Corps of Engineers, Natural Heritage Bureau, and New Hampshire Fish and Game Department. And as part of the project, a fun item we get to do is monitor construction daily and remove turtles and snakes off matting safely so they're not trampled by equipment, which is fun. We also get to do rare plant surveys for Great Burrweed, which is known in the right-of-way. And basically, we would ensure that matting doesn't overlap those rare plants. And so that's done in advance and then during construction. And then another, I think, positive outcome of this project is that a new osprey platform will be constructed as part of this project about 160 feet north of an existing nest that's on a utility pole in active electrified infrastructure, which right isn't where we want our rare uncommon animals. So the little bird picture you see will be the new platform that was reviewed by Fish and Game, and that will be installed as part of this. And then another positive offshoot of the project is that there's a relatively large in-lieu fee that goes to the ARM fund as part of mitigation. It's looking to be roughly $154,000 that would go into the watershed, and any municipality in the watershed, like Portsmouth, could apply for those funds later. But also in working with planning staff and the Conservation Commission, Eversource has offered to donate another source of funding to do wetland delineation on what we call the Banfield property, which is another conservation project in town. So that's another positive offshoot of what is really a maintenance project. There's no increase in the right-of-way size. There's no new lines. This is just simply to maintain the existing infrastructure that's there. Mm-hmm. And with that, I'm happy to answer any questions.
Questions, Ms. Moreau?
Would you have any objection to using silt sop versus silt fence?
I don't think we have objections. Can I look at Eversource? Okay. Sure.
Great. That's my only question.
One thing we do like about
our prior chairman was very fond of only using silk socks, so okay. I'm trying to make sure his traditions continue.
One reason why we do tend to like straw wattle is you can cut the mesh, and then there's stabilizing materials inside that you can leave, so there's less trash and things to dispose of. So
then
less
you can't
less,
let the animals jump over.
Yeah. So it's less waste in the end, but certainly if that's a preference of the board, we're happy to do that.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you.
Other questions for the applicant? Mr. Clark.
So is timber matting going to be used for pretty much all access?
Correct, because it's pretty much, as you know, from this right-of-way being Great Bog, most of the area is wetland. So for the most part, then we would install stabilized stone construction entrances that are temporary off of matting in those narrow upland areas.
Okay.
To prevent sediment from washing down.
Is this very similar to the project that was on Lovering Lane in Northampton? Do you know where that is?
I don't know about that project, but timber matting is a standard of the industry.
Okay.
Yeah. Not familiar with that.
Mr. Clark?
Can you just reiterate how much is going into the ARM fund for this project?
So it's subject to DES review and approval, but roughly $154,000 is what it's looking like, because not only the wetland impacts are included, but the prime wetland buffer impact.
Right.
So it's a pretty large amount.
And so... Okay, because this is all in Portsmouth can apply for that entire...
Almost all in Portsmouth, a little bit in Greenland.
Okay.
But any community in the watershed could apply.
Right, okay.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Perkins?
Are these lines part of the distribution system or sort of the transmission grid?
Transmission.
Okay, and so will the new structures that are built, will they be capable of handling any future upgrades Eversource might undertake? Because I know the lines aren't being upgraded, just the structures, right?
I'm going to defer to my construction representative.
Oh, sure. I can repeat. I was just wondering if the new structures that are going to be built here could support future upgrades to the actual transmission lines themselves.
They will pretty much be as they are now. Okay. The only upgrades possibly could be wire size, but that's not part of this.
Okay.
This is just simply maintenance.
Can you introduce yourself and just...
Sorry. Kevin Clough with Eversource?
Either one. Say that again.
Kevin Clough with Eversource?
Thank you.
Thanks, Kevin. I didn't want to misspeak.
Was that a question?
That's what I understood.
Yeah, I just didn't know if they replaced lines in the future, if there would be another impact to the well. And
it sounds like it's possible.
Sounds like it's possible, yes.
Ms. Lejek.
Just a curious question. Once you replace these supports, you're replacing the wood supports, how many more would be in existence in this area? Are the majority of supports for the lines made out of wood currently, or is the majority?
There's some near the substation that are metal, if that answers your question, but what we're replacing is largely wood.
Right, so replacing the wood, I'm just wondering, is this an ongoing improvement project that we're going to see more of these replacements, or is this something that's near the end that we've already replaced the majority of the wood frame structures, or?
All of our wood frames are kind of, we're leaning towards the light duty steel now.
Okay.
It's got a better life expectancy. Woodpeckers don't affect it. So that's kind of like our new standard now.
Yeah, I understand that. So how far along are we with replacing of the wood?
On this section, we haven't done any yet. It's just as we get to it.
As it starts to fail, you're going to replace
it?
So
we don't have a change out policy at this time.
Okay. And this line's gotten selected based on the failure rate.
We had one failure earlier this year, and it's in pretty rough shape, so we kind of pushed it up to the front.
And the lifespan of the steel replacements are?
I'm not sure yet. We haven't really got too many in the ground, so.
Okay.
This is kind of like our first major project with the steel.
All right. So other than ice storms, you don't expect to replace them anytime soon, take it.
We hope not, right?
Right. Thank you.
Sure. Thanks. Other questions? Mr. Clark.
So to kind of build off Mr. Ledeck's comment, so we could be seeing this again in the future as more wood structures are replaced in the bog.
I think we'll be out of the bog for the most part at the end of this structure. Then everything should be mainly in uplands unless we have find others as time goes on.
It's a pretty extensive effort. We have a standard dredge and fill wetland application in front, obviously that huge mitigation fee, so we don't really have any interest to come back unless there's something we don't know about now. This is really an overall effort to try to fix all the structures in this right away at this moment.
Councilor Perkins.
I don't want
to. Are you Mr. Clark?
The only other thing was I'm just looking at, you know, there's definitely a wetland on page 3 of 4, and basically you have poles 49, 48, 47 on that line that, I guess my question is, if there would, are we just going to have to come back and replace them 5 years from now?
I guess as a maintenance program, we will come back on this other side. We're not going to generally do the whole line. This is a kind of like a worse section, I should say, at this point.
But there's no immediate plans,
no,
right?
No, not that I know of.
Councilor Perkins.
Along similar lines, I guess. There are no current plans to actually upgrade the line in the next 5 to 10 years.
Not that I know of. We're just pretty much putting in new poles, transferring the existing conductor.
Other questions of the applicant? If not, I'll open up the public hearing. Thank you. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Any second-time speakers? Third-time speakers? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. What's the wish of the board?
Mr. Chair, I'd make a motion that we vote to approve the conditional permit with the included stipulations that were in the planning board memo.
Second.
Any?
Can I?
Yes.
Can I add in something? I almost
absolutely
forgot my silt sock.
You may.
Thank you.
Yes. So you have a third stipulation, don't you?
Yes. I'm out of practice.
Silk stocks. Are you willing to accept that?
I am.
Okay. So we have a motion and a second. Discussion? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The chair votes aye.
Thank you.
Yeah, no. Item C, the application of Chance B and Edward R. Allen, owners, for property located at 88 Sims Ave, requesting conditional use permit approval under section 10.1017 of the zoning ordinance, will work within the inland wetland buffer for the construction of a 208 square foot addition to a single family residence with 300 square feet of impact to the inland wetland buffer. Said property is shown on Assessor's Map 232 as Lot 131 and lies within the single residence B district. Who's here to speak for this applicant?
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. My name is Phelps Fullerton of Fullerton Associates. I prepared the architectural drawings and the plans for this application, and I'll be speaking to it this evening for the
owners.
Sorry, I don't mean to interrupt, but I'm going to recuse myself because for receiving a butter notification.
Okay. So noted.
The property is an existing single-family residence on a 0.48-acre lot located in the SRB district. The structure currently encroaches 10.4 feet into the 30-foot front yard setback and almost 80 feet into a 100-foot rear wetlands buffer. The owners are proposing construction of a 208-square-foot addition off the side of the existing house with a small Juliet deck. The new addition would not extend any further toward the wetlands than the main living area of the house currently does, and extend just 3.5 feet into the front yard setback, which is substantially less than the 10.4 feet the house currently extends. In separate but related applications, we have appeared before the Conservation Commission last week, where we received unanimous approval moving forward. And we were also at the BOA meeting on Tuesday evening, where we were granted a front yard setback variance. The zoning ordinance, Article 10, Section 10.1016 of the wetlands buffer, includes a provision that permits construction of an addition to a single family residence in the buffer, provided it meets several criteria. And I've listed those in your package. We meet two out of the three. The first is that the footprint shall not exceed 25% of the area of the principal heated structure, which we're in compliance with. Number two, the addition shall be no closer to a wetland or water body than the existing principal structure, and we're in compliance with that. Where we didn't initially meet compliance was with the third condition, that the addition shall conform with all other provisions of the zoning ordinance. And that's why we needed that front yard setback variance on Tuesday evening. Would you like me to speak to the six criteria for approval?
I would ask, you don't need to unless there's questions from the board.
Okay.
Since it's included in your documentation that you presented to the board.
That essentially concludes my presentation. I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Questions for the applicant, Ms. Moreau?
What is the purpose of the addition?
It's to provide more common area living space. It's a rather modest first floor, and they just simply don't have additional common area space. We've really tried to be cognizant of the wetland setback to the rear. We've actually angled the end of the addition that kind of just keeps it within existing encroachment of the heated area. And when you calculate the net interior width, we're at 12 and a half feet. So if you push it back another 2 feet, you're almost creating a obsolete, dysfunctional living space. Probably wouldn't be worth it to the applicant.
Mm-hmm. Other questions of the applicant? Thank you.
I'll
open it up to public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers? Any third time speakers? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. What's the wish of the board?
Mr. Chair, I could make a motion that we vote to approve the conditional use permit
with the applicant shall install a drip edge at the outer edge of the new addition to prevent erosion and allow infiltration of stormwater, and that the applicant shall also install additional native plantings in the previously disturbed area inside the fence at the rear of the property, as requested by the Conservation Commission.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The chair votes aye. Congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you.
It's recommended that the next two items, items D and E, be discussed together and voted on separately. I'll read them into the record, and then I'm going to ask for a motion to consider these two items together. Item D, the application of Pease Development Authority owner and Summit Land Development LLC applicant for property located at 160 Corporate Drive, requesting conditional use permit approval under section 10.1017 of the zoning ordinance, or work within the inland wetland buffer for construction of a two-story manufacturing office building with a footprint of 85,500 square feet and 190 parking spaces, with 178 square feet of impact to the inland wetland buffer. Said property is shown on Assessor's Map 313 as Lot 2 and lies within the Pease Airport Business Commercial District. And item E, the application of Pease Development Authority owner and Summit Land Development LLC applicant for property located at 160 Corporate Drive, requesting site plan approval to construct a two-story manufacturing and office building with a footprint of 85,500 square feet, including 190 parking spaces, with related paving, lighting, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said property is shown in Assessor's Map 313 as Lot 2 and lies within the Pease Airport Business Commercial District. Who's here to speak before the applicant?
Good evening, Mr. Chair, Planning Board. My name is Sean Toby. I'm a civil engineer with Hoyle Tanner and Associates. In this project, well, I'm representing Chad Cagliari with Summit Land Development. And for this project, it's for the construction of a 97,700 square foot manufacturing and office building for Revision Military. They are a Canadian-based company that manufactures military-grade helmets, body armor, and eyewear protection. So they recently have won some large contracts with the U.S. Army to produce helmets. So they're looking to expand into New Hampshire and more specifically Portsmouth and Pease because of some of the local composite community college programs. And with the helmets, there's a high demand for, you know, composites, and they're looking to work together with those to create, you know, internships. And it's anticipated with this project that it also create 150 new jobs within the local community because they're a completely new company to the state. So that's just a little background information on the company that's moving into this building. Now, the existing site, as mentioned, is located at 160 Corporate Drive on the Tradeport. It's an 8.67 acre site. It formerly contained Air Force housing. Still has remnants of the old road, some of the driveways and the existing utilities. All the buildings have been removed from in the past. And this is one of the last few sites on Pease that can truly accommodate a building of this, you know, upwards of close to 100,000 square feet. And what we've done with the site is we've really tried to push the building towards the back to create a lot of green and open space at the front of the site. The parking as well, we kind of tucked on the side as much as we could with just a single parking row in the front. The parking for the building is based on PDA regs for office and manufacturing space, and we'll have 190 spaces, as well as two loading docks for trucks to come in with shipping and receiving for the manufacturing products. We've also provided sidewalk connectivity to and from Corporate Drive, and as well as around the building. We've also provided bike racks, as well as an outdoor patio, a pervious patio space for the employees. And with this development, we still maintain 46% open space on the site, which is well above the 25% requirement. And the plan for the site, because of this contract that they won, is they want to construct the building in two phases. The first phase would be here in the front, which is a little over 41,000. The second phase would be in the back. But as part of the site design, everything would be constructed all at once, and then the addition would just go on the back. Well, so they would get in, get operational, and then expand the building while still in operation. As far as drainage for the site, We are required to get an alteration of terrain permit through New Hampshire DES. So we need to meet treatment requirements, channel protection, groundwater recharge, and peak runoff rate control. So to do this on the western portion of the site, we have a large infiltration system. It'll be underground, provide treatment, infiltrate the water back into the ground, as well as providing peak runoff rate control. And on the eastern side of the site, all the stormwater drains to a grass-lined treatment swale, and then into the detention basin. So all the peak runoff rates from the site are being reduced. We're meeting our treatment. We're recharging water into the ground. And we're also providing channel protection for the adjacent streams. As far as utilities for the site, the sewer will just connect to an existing sewer line through an easement on the adjacent parcel. And the other utilities will just connect back to Corporate Drive. And the site will feature LED lighting throughout to provide an energy reduction. As far as landscaping, we've provided street trees throughout the access on the front, around the parking, and as well as in the islands throughout the site. And we've also provided arborvitaes and pines in areas where to screen from the sides, and as well as around the dumpster pad and the utilities. And as far as a conditional use permit for use within a wetland buffer for the site, that permit is for the driveway connection to Corporate Drive. In that section, pretty much most of Corporate Drive is within the buffer for Hodgson Brook on the opposite side of the street. So in order to connect the driveway safely back into Corporate, we have to cross through a small portion of that buffer where it's already been bisected through with Corporate Drive. And the second portion of the conditional use permit is for two existing drainage outfalls that were part of the existing road that discharge into Newfields Ditch there that are in the buffer. And as part of the TAC, they asked us to just remove those and restore it back to the existing conditions. And as far as all the site development, there's no on-site, with the exception of the driveway entrance. Everything is out of the buffer. There are no wetland impacts with the development. And working with Peter Britz and the Conservation Commission, there's an area in the back of the site shown here where there's a man-made drainage swale that discharges into Newfields Ditch. And as part of as an offset for the driveway, we're gonna enhance that area. It's currently been mowed, so we're just gonna let it restore to a natural state. And then we're also gonna provide additional plantings in that area to just try to enhance it as much as we can. So that's about an 8-to-1 kind of enhancement to our disturbance ratio there. And we've worked extensively with PDA kind of throughout the design and have addressed any comments that they have had. And we've also addressed any comments that the TAC had from the last meeting within this set of plans here. And if there's any questions, I'd be more than happy to answer anything.
Questions for the applicant? Ms. Moreau.
Based off the fact that you're doing a phase one and a phase two, is the actual site going to be fully in place with phase one, or is that being phased as well, or is it
no,
just the
correct.
Building section?
The whole site, everything with the site would all be constructed under phase one, and the phase two area would just be brought to grade and grassed, and then when it's time to construct phase two, they would just go in and have very minimal disturbance to the site, okay. And they can remain in operation.
Thank you.
Mr. Gall.
Yes, thank you. You described the new plantings very well during your presentation, but I was wondering if you could just describe how you're minimizing impact on existing trees and shrubs on that site.
Yeah, a lot of the trees, so most of the area is cleared throughout the center. There's a small pocket of trees in here, and there's some brush kind of along this edge. But a majority of those trees are, there's really no specimen trees that we could save. With other sites on Pease, there have been some oak trees we've tried to save. But with this project, there was just nothing that was really feasible to save.
Mr. Clark.
I do appreciate what you've done to try to satisfy the AOT requirements. Just a couple of questions kind of on that front. The overflow weir for the subsurface infiltration system, when does that weir, basically what storm event do you start seeing flow over that weir? I know you have some flow at the 2-year peak flow, design point 3 if I'm reading that right, but I just out of curiosity, just trying to get a sense of, you know, when, basically how much, what storm event can this system handle and kind of keep all that, everything on site?
I believe it's, I know the two-year can handle all of that and infiltrate it. And then I believe the 10, it starts to bleed a little bit off. Eventually, you get more water coming in than it can infiltrate.
Right.
But it stores that, the amount of volume that it stores per the requirement was much greater. But I believe the 25-year storm, it starts to peak. And then it has to maintain a foot of freeboard within that so it's not overtopping. So I believe it's designed for the 25-year.
Oh, the, okay, yep. Great. And then going to the, moving over to the infiltration basin, just out of curiosity, did you guys, in your HydroCAD model, model the grate itself? Because I know sometimes that can cut down on your discharge capacity by basically if you model all the little metal pieces.
Yeah, no, we modeled the 30-inch outlet pipe and then all of that. So that's a primary discharge, and then all the other orifices, including the grate,
okay,
route through that 30-inch pipe.
Right.
So it is accounted for, yes.
Excellent.
Other questions for the applicant? Thank you. Now I'll open it up to public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers? Third time speakers? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. It's the wish of the board.
Chair, I'd like to move to approve the, or vote to recommend approval, actually, of the conditional use permit with the stipulations as provided in the planning staff memorandum.
Second. We have a motion and a second. Discussion? Councillor Perkins.
This is more of a procedural question than anything, but I'm noticing in our memo from staff under the wetland conditional use permit section in bullets 4 and 5, there's the last sentences say staff recommends a stipulation to minimize impacts to existing trees and shrubs for this work, and then staff recommends an area that wetland buffer restoration be included on the plan to offset this impact. So if I'm understanding correctly, we're providing some feedback and recommendation to PDA, and their staff would include these stipulations in the PDA's approval? I'm just trying to understand.
So I think that, and maybe Peter Britz is here, he can correct me if I'm wrong, but the recommendations from the staff were incorporated into the stipulations. And basically what this is, the way we work is the planning board advises a recommendation to the PDA. If the PDA doesn't change that within a certain period of time, then basically by default it's adopted. So this isn't actually a recommendation to staff, this is actually a recommendation to the PDA. And I believe, right, Peter, your stipulations were rolled into their staff recommendations were rolled into the stipulations.
That's right. The planting area in the back he added is already in the plan, but it's still a recommendation to the PDA.
It's already been incorporated. Understood.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks, Peter. Other comments? So we have a motion and a second, right? Mm-hmm. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. And now site plan approval. Site plan review, I'm sorry. Site plan review approval.
Chair, I'd also like to recommend that we vote to recommend site plan review approval.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The chair votes aye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Item F has been postponed. Where are we? G. Item G. The application of Alexander C. Garside and Nicole Outset, owners for property located at 212 Park Street, and the Trudy Gold Irrevocable Living Trust owner, William A. Gold, trustee, for property located at 226 Park Street, requesting preliminary and final subdivision approval, a lot line revision between two lots as follows. Lot 1, map 149, Lot 50, decreasing in area from 13,218 square feet to 8,736 square feet, with 47.69 feet of contiguous street frontage on Park Street. And Lot 2, map 149, Lot 51, increasing in area from 7,597 square feet to 12,079 square feet, with 50 feet of continuous street frontage on Park Street. Said lots lie within the municipal district and character District 5, which have no minimum requirements for lot area or street frontage. Who's here to speak for the applicant?
I am. Good evening. My name is Zhang Garside, and along with my wife, Nicole, I own 212 Park Street. I'm also here to speak on behalf of Bill Gould, who's the trustee for the trust that owns 226 Park Street. It's a fairly straightforward lot line adjustment. As indicated in the application that you have, but briefly I'll explain, there is a small piece of land that wraps around from 226 Park Street around the back of the 212 Park Street lot that we wish to purchase from Bill, in effect. And so instead of his lot wrapping around behind our lot will wrap around behind his lot. That's it in a nutshell.
Questions for the applicant? Thank you. I'll open it up to public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Seeing no one rise. Second time speakers? Third time speakers? I'll close the public hearing. What's the wish of the board?
Mr. Chair, I vote that we grant preliminary and final subdivision approval with the included stipulations. This subdivision certainly makes more sense than what's there now.
Yes, indeed.
Agreed.
Second. We have a motion and a second discussion. If not, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. Thank you. Item H, the application of Paul M. and Laura L. Manley, owners, for property located at 1490 Islington Street, requesting conditional use permit approval to create a one-bedroom, 727-square-foot attached accessory dwelling unit on the first floor of an existing single-family residence with associated paving, lighting, and utilities. That property is shown on Assessor's Map 233 as Lot 108 and lies within the single residence B district. Who's here to speak before for this applicant?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name is Bernie Pielich. I'm here on behalf of Mr. and Mrs. Mantle, who could not be here this evening. 1490 Islington Street is about 125 years old. It's a very old house built in the 1890s, and Mr. Mantle and his wife have owned it for the past 27 years. He would like to put an accessory dwelling unit inside the existing single-family residence. We went before the zoning board on Tuesday evening and received necessary variance, and the variance that was required was because the 125-year-old house was 5 feet from Islington Street, which made it a non-conforming structure. With a granting of the variance, it is now a legal non-conforming structure and therefore now qualifies for the ADU. All of the other requirements for the accessory dwelling unit are met. Mr. Mantle has submitted a very complete and thorough application. There's no exterior changes to the building. All of the changes are interior. He will be residing on the first floor. The second floor will be the ADU. There's no business uses. The parking meets the requirements of the ADU ordinance. And I have a petition signed by numerous abutters supporting it, saying we, the undersigned neighbors and abutters of 1490 Islington Street, fully support Mr. Mantle's plans to convert his home into an accessory dwelling at it. We ask the Board of Adjustment to grant the necessary variances and the Planning Board to grant the conditional use permit for the ADU. Question came up at the ZBA meeting on Tuesday as to why the ADU wasn't proposed to be in the barn, but the barn is in so old and in such bad shape it would cost prohibitive. It has a wooden floor and is in bad shape. Putting the ADU attached into the house is certainly much better than a proposal to do a garden cottage in the barn. So with that, I will present the petition. And if the board has any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer them for you. Thank you.
Thank you. Questions? Apparently not.
Thanks. Thank you.
Presentation. I'll open up the public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers. Third time speakers. See no one rise. I close the public hearing. What's the wish of the board?
Mr. Chair, I make a motion that we vote to find this application satisfies all of the requirements and that we grant the conditional use permit as presented with the included stipulation. I'd also add that I think this is exactly what the ADU law was talking about when it was created. So it's nice to see one that sort of fits directly within all of our, all the things that we talked about when we created it.
Mm-hmm. Second.
Discussion? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The chair votes aye. So this is footprint, right?
Yes.
Okay. Item I. The application of Christopher L. and Ann D. Schultz, owners, for property located at 140 Orchard Street, requesting conditional use permit approval to create a two-story, one-bedroom with a footprint of a garden cottage with a footprint of 584 square feet. Mm. So that, make that note, in an existing building with associated paving, lighting, and utilities. Said property is shown on Assessor's Map 149 as Lot 38 and lies within the General Residence A District. Who's here to speak for the applicant?
Anna Schultz and my husband, Chris Schultz. We live at 140 Orchard Street, and the house was built in 1910. There's a barn detached, and we're asking for the garden cottage permit. We feel we meet all of the appropriate things requested, and we have support of over 20 neighbors that have signed in support of that. We have, like I said, met all the requirements. There were two things that we were kind of asking for. The parking, we can fit four cars in that parking space, in that the driveway that we currently have, but because of the right-of-way, legally we can't fit the four. So I actually changed something with the help of our builder and in speaking with the planning department, that we could even put just some pavers in the grass in order to not change the look of the property at all and add pavement or anything like that if needed. The other request was, I thought I had requested over 1,000 feet. So when you read 584, I was a little confused, but the barn would not change in any form, and it currently has two floors in it. It would just be filling the first and second floor space. And I just want to stress that we don't want to change the look of the property at all. We have a patio that's in between the primary dwelling and the barn, and nothing would change. We're also not looking to change. We have some very large pine trees, and we're adjusting the foundation in order to, I forget what they're called, like pylon kind of footers.
Footings.
For half of the barn, mm-hmm. and then the second half would be a slab in order to not affect those large pine trees along the side as well. So.
Questions of the applicant? So is there any reason why you cannot construct an ADU that's within the 600 square feet required by the ordinance?
We are just asking to extend that. It would be spray foamed anyway, as we're trying to make it as environmentally appropriate as possible, and that would be a finished space upstairs, my understanding is, with spray foam. And we'd like to make it a little bit larger in order to accommodate the plan is for family to live there.
Other questions? Ms. Moreau?
So if I understand this right, you actually access your driveway from not Orchard Street, but from Ash Street?
Yeah, we're on the corner.
Right. It took me a while to actually figure out where everything was. So you, I mean, I see a picture with two cars parked here now, so I guess I don't completely understand where the pavers would go and how you would extend that. Can you explain that a little bit better?
Yep, so if you look at the barn, there's and from the road, there's grass to the right of that, and that's where the pavers would go, right next to that. So I mean, you could potentially line three cars up, and like I said, functionally you can actually fit four, but because of the right-of-way that we're proposing to do that, and we don't want to take any green space away.
So where is the right-of-way? Could you explain that to me?
It's just along the road, and I don't know exactly.
Oh, so you're talking about, is Ash Street a public street or
yeah.
is it a private street?
Oh yeah,
it's a public
yeah.
street.
Public.
Okay.
It's yeah. just as
so
well.
So you're talking about you, because of the street, you're too close to the street.
Right.
Exactly.
Okay. Okay. Now I'm getting it.
Sorry.
I was thinking there was like something on the side.
No, sorry, I'm not. I wasn't clear.
The actual right-of-way line is farther back than the street edge.
Okay.
So they
okay.
their apparent property line is different than
their
what
actual they're
actually
property
using.
Line.
Yeah. Right.
Now I get
that,
it.
That would give you the view.
Right,
yeah.
right. Okay.
I'm sorry.
No. Sorry, could I ask one more?
Sure.
So, yeah, because it is a little confusing in here where the actual application states 584 plus square feet, but then it says 1,068 square feet. So you...
That's what we had our neighbors sign that statement saying that, you know, and that's what we'd like to do.
Yeah, my understanding is the footprint of the garage yeah.
is the 584.
Oh,
okay.
And it's a two-story structure, okay. and they're asking to build a cottage unit of 1,068 square feet
because it'll
within
be
two that story. Two stories.
Yeah. Correct.
Ms. Begala.
So just to be very clear, even though it'll be 1,068 square feet, it would be one residence.
Yes.
It's not like 4-2.
No. Just one.
Yeah. How many bedrooms?
Two.
Two bedrooms.
Oh. So your application actually said one bedroom? Or we,
yeah.
unless we. So
that's
two bedroom?
Yeah. I'm
okay.
sorry. I wasn't clear
I was
on
gonna
that.
Say, I thought I read one bedroom somewhere. But.
Well, yeah. I mean, which. Your plan labels an office in a bedroom
mm-hmm.
on the second floor. Maybe that's why.
Yeah.
But the intent is two bedrooms.
I mean, yes.
Other questions?
Just
yes.
one other question, Chair. So had you, considering that it's tight with the parking in terms of the four spaces, had you thought at all about maybe having parking on the first floor of the barn and making a smaller unit?
We did, but the there's because of the barns there's not a lot of headroom because of the sides are only I think 5 feet maybe 6 feet on the edge, so you actually are taking away that space, you know, as far as if there's a tall person like my husband and we're living there. Does that
Jim,
make sense?
It, Jim might be able to address it here.
Okay.
Jim.
Okay, help.
I'm Jim Wakefield from Architectural Builders. I'm their contractor. There's a big row of trees between them and their neighbor that we're trying to maintain. So we're doing the foundation only under half of the barn. We're putting frost posts under the other half. So it's only 10 feet wide. So there's not room for a car to be able to park inside. Without cutting down all the trees, taking out all the stumps, extending the foundation the full width of the building.
So the The front of the barn is only 10 feet wide?
No, it's 20. We're putting a foundation under one half of the 10 feet of the width.
I see.
The rest is cantilevered over a steel beam and some frost posts so that we're not damaging the roof.
So that wouldn't support the weight of a car?
Exactly.
Got it.
And also my point, too, that because of the height of the edge, you're narrowing the second floor as well.
Are there questions of the applicant?
Oh, no.
Nothing good?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you. I'd open up the public hearing. Anyone speaking to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers. Third time speakers. Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. What's the wish of the board?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Referencing,
Mr. Moore.
Referencing one of our earlier work session discussions about mode of making motions, I will put this, make this motion for discussion purposes, which is to approve of the conditional use permit before us.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. So, Mr. Moore, would you like to comment on your motion?
Well, in general, Mr. Chairman, I think I wanted to facilitate the discussion and invite comments from other board members. As I view the application, as well as the intent of the accessory dwelling unit ordinance, it occurs to me that I don't recall a previous application where we've had a good discussion about the exceedance of the recommended square foot for the the cottage. And I just want to make sure I have that right. The 600 square feet is what is permitted via the ordinance, whereas this structure, which is an existing structure, which makes it a garden cottage, has the ability to have 1,600 square feet of living space. And so it caused me to want to inquire of the planning department about the accessory nature of this dwelling unit, and how does if we could be reminded of the thinking that went into a square footage limitation of that sort in for this garden cottage application.
Yeah, I mean, I think the square footage, other members of the board were participated in that discussion, so might have additional insight, but I believe the reason for setting a maximum gross floor area is really to maybe supplement a bedroom requirement, maximum bedroom requirement or something like that, and really to make it an accessory unit that doesn't have multiple bedrooms and can have capacity for a large family potentially that could have more impact on the neighborhood, meaning that you could potentially have a number of individuals, potentially cars, or there could be increased noise. So I think that probably the discussion, correct me if I'm wrong, around the gross floor area was as an alternative to setting sort of a maximum in terms of the actual composition of the dwelling unit in terms of bedrooms or other impacts. I would say that I think while this, you know, certainly this is the first time the planning board has heard had a request for dimensional relief under the ADU, and I think it's worth thinking very hard, very, you know, having a good discussion about whether or not it merits, because it's almost double the amount. I think there were probably some conditions that the applicant brought up that make it a viable reason to retain it in the existing condition and maybe not chop it up into a smaller space for the purpose of retaining the historical integrity of the structure without having sort of unused space in there. And I think probably the parking, not being able to put parking in there, was also another argument. But certainly it's worth the planning board thinking hard about making exceptions in this case, because this is the first one you've had in front of you.
Are there comments or discussion? Ms. Moreau and then Vice Perkins.
From my memory of our discussion, when we talked long and hard about all the different ADUs that we could incorporate, we had this want to have the possibility, because the detached was not required under the state law. So we had this long discussion about having something detached in existing buildings. And I do agree that I think the whole 600 square feet was something we pulled together because we didn't want these to end up being, so our concern was, okay, you have a garage, you want to put something, you know, an ADU upstairs, great. We didn't want this to affect the neighbors. So I think by limiting the square footage, it meant that they weren't going to put a ton more windows and they weren't going to be, you know, have lights overseeing into people's backyards that maybe have not done so before. So there was a whole discussion about limiting the square footage in order for that to be, you know, because obviously we didn't know when we put this together. We were kind of sort of anticipating what people might want. So that was my recollection of where the 600 square feet came to. And honestly, if it was at least within the 750 square feet, that is kind of the maximum under the state law, I probably wouldn't have heartburn over this, but these, you know, being all the way up to over 1,000 square feet, I guess I do start to get concerned about the density of the neighborhood, adding that many more people living in a small space. Is that then going beyond what the whole meaning of the ADU? So I can clearly argue both sides of this and very easily convince myself probably, you know, one way or the other. So where this is so early on in the process, I find it hard to want to allow something to be this far out of the realms of what we did. But if we continue to find that, yes, everyone who has a barn that wants to do this ends up being this big and it doesn't seem to be a problem for the neighborhood, then maybe that's something we relook at in the future. But as of right now, I don't know if I'd be willing to expand past the, this far past the 600 square feet requirement, but I don't know what other people think.
Councilor Perkins.
I appreciate your thorough and well thought out comments. So I feel that we probably chose that criteria for similar reasons, I agree. However, I think one of our intentions was also to see these historic structures, which are an important part of our city and our character, be revitalized and preserved. And I feel that that goal is very much accomplished by this plan. While it feels material, I don't feel like 250 square feet is really that far away. I understand it's 600 versus 1,000 square feet, but as Ms. Moreau mentioned, you know, we kind of have this concept of a 750 square foot ADU, which I don't think is unreasonable. So, you know, these guys don't have control over how this historic structure was built. They're putting it to its highest and best use. And the point of the zoning ordinance, you know, making that use accessory and protecting the neighbors is to give the neighbors that protection. The fact that they've all kind of signed on, you know, they're kind of waiving that protection. So I don't want us to kind of stand in for them. If they've spoken for themselves, I don't feel the need to enforce on their behalf. So I think it's kind of showing that this is a good use of the ADU. It's been a compromise with the neighborhood, and I would support the application.
Other comments or questions? So I think Beth said it well, and I think Councilor Perkins had. You can make the argument on either side, but to me, you can save this building and renovate it, and still put a 600 square foot ADU in it. I get why the applicant wants to maximize the space. If I had it, I would too. But we were purposeful as a board when we set 600 square feet. And the purpose was not just in this instance, but in other instances throughout the city, that the accessory dwelling unit, in fact, is accessory and not primary. And when you begin to get to 1,000 square feet, this isn't much smaller than the living space in the existing house, and you have the potential of having a lot more people in it than I think this board envisioned when it came up with the detached ADUs and the garden cottages. The problem is it's a terrific renovation, but there's a reason to have the ordinance. So I can't support the approving this. Mr. Tissot.
What was the board's thinking of how many people to have to live in one of these? I see a two-bed right here, and I could see a couple with maybe at the most two kids sharing a second bedroom. That would be four people. Was it more just to have maybe two, three people living in a house?
I mean, I didn't think in the discussion they didn't try and regulate it by number of people, but they got there by starting with the state law, which was 750 square feet, and worked from that.
Well, I was not going to talk to your point.
Yeah, go ahead.
So I don't want to interrupt.
No, I'm done.
Okay. Well, I was going to say, in considering the difference between an ADU and a two-family use, I think that's really the question. And when the board adopted the detached ADU, which was not a requirement of the state law, mm-hmm. we did that specifically with regard to existing buildings in mind. But I do think that it's the difference between an ADU and a two-family use would be that there's no additional lot area requirement. So when you, and there would be under a two-family use, which is substantially the same impact, except that the ADU is required to be smaller under the ordinance. So I think it's worthwhile to have this discussion about what the intent of an accessory dwelling unit is versus a two-family use, because I think that in this instance, I also love the idea that a barn is being reused. You know, I'm a fan of that. But, you know, one kind of asked, that's why I asked the question that I did. You know, one wonders if, you know, this particular existing building wouldn't be better used as a accessory dwelling unit that met the criteria of the ordinance. And I think that the board, I'm including myself here, you know, needs to think carefully about the exemptions that it's granting to make sure that it is, we're using the ordinance as intended.
Other comments? Ms. Record.
I guess I'm being redundant, but I agree with the chair and Ms. Monroe and what was just said, that, you know, this is the ordinance, that this is our first time out, and to already be making a change when we did come up with the square footage. And I think it's a great building, but I too see that it could be a great building and just be a one bedroom that fit with the intended ordinance.
Mr. Gamester?
I'm okay with this, actually, and mainly because, although we did set, first of all, we added the garden cottage, the detached, we did set square footage parameters. I look at this more as application by application, and whether or not we're setting a precedent does not worry me, because we're looking at this lot, this existing structure, this neighborhood, that street, the fact that they have the abutters, or at least a list of people that are supporting the project. And I also wonder if, well, speaking to the assistant city manager, deputy city manager, comment.
Or you.
Either one. Talk to both of you. It's fine. I'm thinking the difference between a two-family and the whole concept of the ADU, Dadu, garden cottage, whatever you want to call it, is that the requirement will always be that, you know, the owner has to live on site, whereas in a two-family it can be fully rented, and it can be fully rented to its max. I just think there's a certain set of there's a personal touch to having an ADU or a detached ADU, simply because the property owner is always on it, and that's the general comment. And then I don't see why, I don't have the ordinance right in front of me, but if density is a concern, I mean, I think we would be able to have the power to say this shall be a one bedroom detached ADU only, and that it cannot be a two bedroom, so that office will stay on the approval. And to even further hammer home the point, there can be no, you know, closet in that room, so therefore it's just a room. Some different idea, I think.
Councilor Perkins.
I really appreciate the creativity of that idea, and I think it's an interesting solution. I find your comment about owner occupancy to be a great point. And I also just additionally want to add that the whole reason we have an ADU ordinance or passed one at all was to ask our residents to be creative and help solve our housing crisis. And here they are stepping up. So I want us to keep an open mind. You know, if the neighborhood is okay with this and they're proposing it, I agree with Mr. Gamster, you know, let's take it one application at a time, so.
Ms. Moreau.
I know, I shouldn't speak again, but I'm going to. Because I have pondered everyone's ideas.
This one's not easy.
I've pondered everyone's ideas, and I totally get where everyone's coming from, and I think the end result is we didn't have a single person show up and say anything against it.
Right.
We did have, in writing, several people that were for it. So mm-hmm. with the need of affordable housing, which I totally agree is a huge issue of the city, if this ends up being the ability to have some affordable housing, I don't want to set a precedent, and I don't want to go down the slippery slope, or in the words of John Ricci, I don't want to open Pandora's box, which he was always worried about. So I just want everyone in the public to know that this is on a case by case. If I support this, I may not support 1,000 square feet, another dwelling unit that might be presented before us just because of this one. So I wanted to make that very clear.
Ms. Walker, does this board have the ability to stipulate that if this is approved as requested, that it become remain a one bedroom?
Yeah, I mean, you can put a stipulation, you know, similar to how you approve something as presented. You can approve it with a stipulation.
And does the city have the ability to monitor that over time?
We do. The ability we would have, though, is through that certificate of annual renewal, which we have yet to actually, you know, see how that's going to work. So, I mean, obviously, whenever there's a stipulation put on something, particularly for residential units, it becomes somewhat challenging for us to monitor it, but we do have that ability to do it through the certificate of renewal, and that would be one of the things we would want to look at. I think keep in mind that sometimes it's hard to distinguish a bedroom space from another living space.
any other comments or questions? Mr. Moore?
I think it's worth as a matter of just putting all the information out there. What would be the other options for this applicant? Meaning, if we aren't comfortable with this as an accessory dwelling unit by the definition and intent of our ordinance, we do in our zoning ordinance have other means by which two units could be placed on this lot through, I'm not sure if they would require a variance. It sounds like I'm certain that they would. So that is another means with different criteria for balancing all the issues that come up with the increase in density that we're talking about. So there would be another process that is designed to accommodate the two-unit situation that they would have access to. I'm sorry?
And yet that would not have planning board review.
Right.
So right.
You would, you know, that would just be something to keep in mind. You wouldn't be able to subject the same kind of criteria in terms of conditional use permit review that you
right.
can now.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right.
No, they would end up going multi-residence, which is allowed under general residence
right.
A.
Right. And there would be a different process because we go through the zoning board who doesn't necessarily consider the same criteria.
The process does exist.
Yep.
And I mean, I think it's worth noting that if this is not approved, the applicant is welcome to come back and ask for 600 square feet
yep.
and get approval. And so it's not as if this board is denying an ADU. It would just be denying an ADU or a garden cottage in this form. So I think there's multiple routes that the applicant can take regardless of how this board votes.
I have a question.
Deputy City Manager.
Question, Chair. Thank
yes.
you for the correct title. I do have a question, actually. So was this application noticed as a one-bedroom ADU?
Yeah.
Yes.
That's a good question.
So I find that to be a fairly significant flaw.
Sure.
That's a good point.
I was going to make the other point that, in fact, this is a GRA district where multifamily is allowed. So this might be a different consideration for the board compared to a detached that would be in an SRA or an SRB district. So that's another point of consideration. But I would actually, you know, it's uncommon to ask the applicant. I am interested in the one-bedroom option, if that is one, based upon sort of the parking requirements. And I'd just rather limit that if we could. But I also wonder if this is a problem as far as notice goes and whether or not we need to look further into that and maybe vote on this at the next meeting.
You may want to, I would recommend you do that if you decide not to put a stipulation on the one bedroom. And I would say that it could very well have been a planning department error in deciphering the materials, but we are still working on what we require of the applicants and their submissions, and sometimes we don't get complete plans and we have to work a little bit harder. So I would say it could have been a planning department error, but either way it was noticed as a one bedroom, and I think it probably would, either if you don't vote on a stipulation that limits it to one bedroom tonight, that you would want to re-notice it.
Well, I was going to make a motion to postpone approval until the next meeting when we can clarify this.
Well, we already have a motion on the table, so we have to deal with that first.
Yeah, I think
well, I would withdraw my motion as the maker.
Okay.
Second, okay.
I was the second. I'm not okay with that, but okay.
In speaking to my the motion that I had made, well, I think it's important to get these protocols right and to have confidence in the decision making. There you were.
It would be helpful if you're going to postpone it. I think it would be helpful to provide some guidance to the planning department and the applicant about whether there should be some consideration of a one bedroom option versus a two bedroom option, because it may be that they come back with a revised version of the application. Or if you want to just consider it as presented and we advertise it as a two-bedroom, that's fine.
I personally think that we need to re-advertise it as a two-bedroom and at the right square footage, because I think that would be important. Because I think the square footage and that were off. Although the petition that everyone signed actually said 1080 square feet, but it didn't actually say how many bedrooms. That's why I think doing the two bedrooms plus the 1068 square feet. And if it's re-noticed and then represented, obviously we might have this discussion all over again about the size of it and the bedrooms. So that in the end becomes a decision of the board that we have to figure out if we're comfortable with or not.
No, I think it's really good.
Mr. Kissel.
It's just a thought of mine. It just seems really backwards to me that if you go over the 600 square feet, the 600 square feet, we're going to want you to only have a one bedroom, but then if you're 600 or below, you have a two bedroom. To me, it just doesn't make sense. I'm comfortable with this being a two bedroom. And my thinking is that this is an existing structure. If this was a brand new structure that, say, the applicant that happened on Middle Road 2 months ago, then I just would be okay with, I would understand this, but because this building was here, I think they were thoughtful in their design. It's unfortunate that they can't park inside, but that's just kind of where I'm leaning right now. So
yes.
I understand that if we do postpone it, I would be in favor of that just to have some more discussion about this, but I certainly would be leaning in favor of this project as it is. So
I'm inclined to see if we can resolve this tonight rather than to post this. The reason I say that,
I'm sorry? Ditto, sorry.
No, and the reason I say that is that I'm not certain, and in fact, I believe that the neighbors would fully support a two-bedroom. I think the neighbors look at this barn every day. They know exactly what it is. I'm certain that the applicants have been straightforward with their neighbors. And I'd be surprised if anyone took their name off that petition. if it was advertised as a two-bedroom rather than a one-bedroom. And so I do believe that we have a bit of a split board here, but I do think that we're better off to give the applicant guidance tonight one way or another.
Mr. Chairman, as the maker of the motion to approve as presented, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Mr. Assistant City Manager.
I would like to make the motion that we approve the application with the stipulation that the unit be a one-bedroom unit, period.
As the second, I will second.
So we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Ms. Moreau.
Can I just ask a question? Could it come back to bite us that it was improperly noticed? That's what I'm wondering.
It could potentially, if it was appealed, that would be one area they would look into. That could be a justification for appeal, but if you're stipulating it as a one bedroom, I think you're addressing that issue.
Does that just mean you're removing a closet from the second bedroom? Or is it just approving it as a one bed?
I defer to the planning department on how they measure that.
It's not easy to define a bedroom, but I would say, you know, we have this problem with the inspections department and determining whether someone is using an existing portion of their house as an accessory dwelling unit without permission. So I can't say it's an easy thing, but there are some building code requirements for a bedroom that would probably be considered, but it's not easy.
Ms. Moreau?
Just to add to that, in real estate terms, you technically don't sell a room unless it has a closet in it. It's considered a bedroom. But earlier tonight, we approved an ADU with a bedroom with no closet. So, you know, you can kind of go both ways. In fact, I almost brought that up. But so, you know, whether or not there's a closet in it can't prevent someone from using it as a bedroom. So that's the way, as she puts it, it's going to be very hard for them to say whether or not it's actually used that way.
Okay. Other comments? So if not, I'm going to call a roll call vote just so we get this right. Yes, Councilor Perkins.
Can we restate the motion?
Mr. Moore?
Sure. To approve the conditional use permit for a one-bedroom ADU.
Garden cottage.
Okay. Thank you.
Still with all the square footage, correct? The 1,068 square feet. Okay.
And with a stipulation in the memo.
And the other stipulations that are in the memo.
Yes, that's my intent.
Okay. Yes, as
All
well.
All right, so let's do a roll call vote, please.
Okay.
Ms. Walker.
All right, so Ms. Record.
Yes.
Mr. LaDuke.
In favor.
Mr. Gamester.
Yes.
Mr. Moore.
Yes.
Ms. Colbert Puff.
Yes.
Ms. Moreau?
Yes.
Ms. Perkins?
Yes.
Mr. Kissel?
Yes.
And the chair?
No.
Okay, so the motion passes.
Congratulations. It took us a while to get there, but we got there. Right, here are we.
We are at
MJ.
MJ.
19 Rye. Item J, the application of Pease Development Authority owner and 19 Rye Street LLC, care of Two International Group applicant for property located at 19 Rye Street, requesting site plan approval to construct a two-story office building with a footprint of 14,859 square feet, including 146 parking spaces with related paving, lighting, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said property is shown on Assessor's Map 305 as Lot 4 and lies within the Pease Airport Business Commercial District. Who is here to speak for the applicant?
Sean Toby with Hoyle Tanner again, representing Dan Palmer with Two International Group. And also here is Bernie Pielich. So for this project, it's for the construction of a new two-story office building. It's a little under 30,000 square feet, and it'll be for the Department of Health and Human Services. Currently, they're located just around the corner on International Drive, and they'll be moving to this new location, and the old building will be removed. The existing site is about 10.4 acres, and it contains three developed properties, Towards the front of the site is 119 International with associated parking. In the center of the site, there's an existing three-story office building that's labeled 15 Rye. And this project would be in this portion here called 19 Rye Street, where there was a former two-story office building that was removed last year in anticipation of this project. So the new building will go in roughly the same location as the building that was removed. So it's basically a redevelopment of that existing area. And there'll be 156 new spaces with the remainder of the site to remain intact. In the parking for the new building, we tried to put as much at the rear of the building as we could, with single drive lanes of parking at the front. We've also provided additional sidewalk connectivity through the site to the two existing buildings, and as well as a connection back to International. So it really kind of improved pedestrian flow through the site. And we've also added bike racks as well. And this site, when fully developed, still maintains 51% open space, which is above the 25% requirement. For drainage for the property, a majority of the existing building and parking is all closed drainage, and it flows into the city's system in Rye Street. So as part of this project, we tried to reduce as much of that as possible by reducing the watersheds that flow to the street. And any new drainage, we installed hydrodynamic vortex separators to try to remove as much pollutants, as many pollutants as possible before going back into the city system. And by reducing the area that's flowing into that, we're also reducing the peak runoff rates as well. And then at the rear of the parking, we also have an additional vortex separator for treatment and a vegetated detention basin at the back. As far as utilities, we'll basically just reconnect to all the existing locations from the former building. We will have to reroute the sewer around the building. And as far as the water, we'll be connecting to the existing trunk line that runs to 15 Rye, and we'll provide an easement to the city to access those valves. And then as far as landscaping, we really tried to provide a lot of landscaping up front because this building is closer to the street. We've added a lot of street trees in here, as well as maintaining the existing mature trees that are grown in this area, providing trees in front of this parking, as well as a lot of heavy landscaping around the building, and as well as putting wetland plantings within the detention basin. And again, we've worked closely with PDA through the process on this project. We've addressed any of their comments, and we gained approval through TAC at the previous meeting. We've addressed all of those stipulations, except for there is one stipulation that we would like to discuss with the board about not including in the design. And we've shown it in this plan, but it was to add an island in this area here. We have previously had just the double stack parking abutting each other, which is allowed under the P's land use controls because we have an island in this area here. So our intent was to really try to push this back 8 feet and allow more green space at the front of the building, allowing more of a berm, and to put more of the trees to shield everything from Rye Street. So we've included it in this plan set just to satisfy the stipulation, but and I guess Bernie could speak more to that, but we would like to request, I guess, a waiver from the tax stipulations.
Yeah, this came up at the July 5th TAC meeting, and it was after the public hearing had been closed that it was discussed that this island should be included, even though it's not required by either the site plan regulations for the city or the PDA. And the problem we have with that island is, number one, it impedes snow removal. It makes it more difficult for snow removal. It also impedes and lessens the snow storage area in the front area where we were planning to put a where we were planning to put more landscaping and more snow storage in the front. I'll get there eventually, I think. Here you go. You can do it, Sean.
There you go.
They don't teach you that in law school. So, yeah, we wanted to increase that area in the front by the 8 feet that we now have to reduce it, and that allows more snow storage. It also, if we eliminate that island which is not required by any regulation, it allows us to directly push the snow into the snow storage area. It also allows us to have more landscaping and more buffering in the front of the lot. So that's why we would hope that that one condition, which was placed upon the recommendation by TAC, can be removed. Thank you.
Thank you.
So I guess if there's any questions from the board, I mean, we can walk you through any of the design process or our thoughts with the site.
Questions for the applicant? Ms. Moreau.
So the landscape island that the TAC is talking about is in the parking lot that's to the left, down the center of it? I guess I'm confused.
Correct.
Because there is a landscape island.
That's this one.
Okay, so the one that is showing on the plan. Thank you.
Yes. We added it to the plan set to satisfy the stipulation, but would like to request to just remove that and just shift that. So this parking in this area would just get shifted back 8 feet, and that green space, instead of being between the cars, would be provided in this space here. So we.
I mean, there appears to be plenty of room for that landscape island and still snow storage and everything else. So I guess, I mean, it doesn't appear to take up that much room. What if it was only 4 feet? Would that be better?
It's still, because when they plow the area, having that landscape island, it creates like a barrier. So it's a maintenance issue. There's the additional cost of the curbing in that area, maintaining the landscaping, running additional irrigation to that area. And especially in the front here as well, there's an existing berm that's like 3 to 4 feet that mounds up to screen from the street. So even if we do add that island, it won't be visible from the street. So our intent was to maintain more green space in front of the vehicles to provide a bigger buffer from the street.
But then no actual greenery within the sea of concrete or asphalt or whatever's there.
In that one section, we wouldn't have greenery. But again, that's not required per the PDA land use regs. We satisfy that by having the island in this row here.
Yep. Other questions? It seems to me that the projects that we've seen lately have tried to incorporate that sort of island parking.
To break up the
expansive parking. Yep. I understand why the applicant may not be inclined to do it, but it is consistent with how this city has approached parking lots, at least recently.
In the end, it's just our recommendation.
Correct.
Have to take
and it's just our recommendation. And the PDA can decide how.
Whether or not to keep it.
To keep it.
Okay. Thank you.
Are there questions of the applicant? Thanks. I'll open up the public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against, please come to the podium. Second time speakers, third time speakers. First time speakers. I'll close the public hearing. That's the wish of the board.
Mr. Chairman, I vote that we recommend to the PDA to approve the site plan with the stipulations from TAC.
We have a second?
Second.
Discussion? Not all in favor?
Aye.
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 No, whoa. Any opposed? The chair votes aye. Congratulations. You want to take a stretch break, guys, or we're in the home stretch?
We're home.
Let's bring it home?
No.
All right. Thank you.
No,
I know. Item K has been postponed. We have item 5, City Council referrals requests. Item A, request for a traffic signal and sidewalk easement from Richard Fusini.
Yep.
Relative to the property located at 1575 Woodbury Ave. Ms. Walker, are you going to just briefly explain this to us?
Yeah, this is related to a traffic signal and sidewalk easement that is an agreement related to this property and that the city has worked with this applicant on. I can't really, there's not much more to add other than what's in your application and your packet. It's a city council referral, so it doesn't require a public hearing. It just requires your vote.
So can I have a motion to approve? A motion to recommend that, to the city council that they accept this traffic circle.
So moved.
And easement.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The chair votes aye. Other business. It gives me great pleasure to suggest that the board consider appointing Jody Record as a planning board representative to the Rockingham Planning Commission.
That's so exciting. As far as I've been here, we've never had one.
If I could have a vote to nominate Ms. Record? I mean, a motion?
Well, should we include Peter Britz, or are we doing
We're going to do them separately, because I'm not sure they both will pass.
I move to nominate Jody Record to the city council for appointment for the Rockingham Planning Commission.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Chair votes aye. Congratulations, Jody.
Thank you.
Represent us well. And if I could have a vote to nominate Peter Britz as a
same motion alternate. For Peter Britz.
Second.
As an alternate.
As an alternate.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Chair votes aye. Any other business to come before this board? Councilor Perkins.
I swear this will be quick. Mr. Chair, it pains me every month when I get this packet and we have these huge plans that nobody can use on the dais. So I'm respectfully requesting that at some point we don't need to receive these huge plans. In fact, I would prefer like a legal sized piece of paper or
11 by 17
electronic version. So whenever that fits into the chair's business, I'd love to discuss it. It would be nice.
Well, no, you know, we actually at our work session we did talk about this, and
okay.
One proposal, and I think there's no reason why we can't implement it, was to ask the planning director to poll the members and ask how they want to receive this documentation. And there really are three options that, as it is today, smaller size, 8 by 11 or whatever that size is.
11 by 17.
11 by 16 or
17.
11 by 17. 17.
Or strictly electronic.
Yeah,
I mean, it's available electronic if you don't want to use the paper ones. I have tried to do that in the past, and it's difficult.
Yeah, the only thing I'd suggest is that, and this isn't a shot at the planning department.
No, we have to make sure
But we need to make sure the electronic information, in fact, is current
exactly.
And complete.
Yes.
And tonight, in fact, it wasn't.
Wasn't.
So,
right.
But I think, unless there's a disagreement, I would ask Ms. Walker to poll the board. For our next meeting.
Yeah, I'm happy to do that. It will actually require a modification to our submission requirements for the site plan review. So we'd actually have to take a formal vote at some point. But I think in the interim, we can probably do that. Yeah. Because the applicants themselves provide these.
They're the ones that provide it.
Yeah.
So we'd be asking them to provide it in two versions.
In a different version, which we already do for TAC. So it's not something they're not used to. But we would want to formalize that in our site plan review requirements.
We already require them to provide in paper and electronic, so it's just a different size paper.
Right.
Yeah. All would be the same.
But in TAC, they're already probably giving it in the smaller version.
We are. Some of us get a large size, some of us get a small.
So it's not requiring
a
burden.
It's not a big change.
So what's your suggestion? Can we vote on this tonight, or should we wait till the next meeting?
Why don't I poll the members, and then I'll have a recommendation on how to revise the site review rates.
That's out of order, Mr.
Just trying to get over.
No.
So I'd like to ask, I just like someone like Corey, who clearly reads plans a little differently than some of us on the board. If on 11 by 17, you could at all times ask the type of questions again. So you'll be able to read, you know, with the notes and everything on it, if there's still enough room for very minor technical things.
Yeah, I mean, I know it's just everything becomes so much smaller. So sometimes people do have trouble with notes and stuff like that. But yeah, I'd be perfectly fine with 11 by 16. I'd prefer it. So.
Then I'm perfectly fine with it.
Well, no, but I think we're presenting the option.
Yeah.
Yes, it doesn't have to be all one.
It doesn't have to be all one or the other.
Yeah.
And so the planning director will poll the board and report back at the next meeting. Which means we'll probably implement it in September.
Yep.
Is that okay, Councilor Perkins?
Thank you, Chair.
I'm very happy.
It's a lot of trees.
To make everyone's worlds better.
No idea.
All right, I have a motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thanks, everyone.
I do have plan sets here.